Joining me to talk all things health and fitness today is a Wallaby legend, Drew Mitchell. How are you, mate?
Mate, good, thanks. Good, mate. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you, mate. Fox Sports, mate. Commentator as well these days. How's life after footy?
Yeah, I mean, it's good. It's obviously, it's got, you know, it's difficulties and obstacles and stuff like that. But, you know, in terms of the Fox stuff, I think for me, the good thing about being involved with Fox is it's, for lack of a better term, it means I don't have to go cold turkey on footy. Yeah. I mean, it was my life for 15 years, and now to be around game day, get that feel, you know, the atmosphere of the crowds, the nervous energy about going live and that type of thing, it kind of helps me wean off rugby. Yeah, so I mean, I enjoy it. I still, you know, get to be around the boys at certain times. I mean, although I'm now, you know, they start to check what they say around me. They think maybe I'm recording everything, but no, it's a good way for me to kind of still stay connected, but also, you know, start my transition out of footy as well.
And mate, the June series coming up, excited about that?
Yeah, really excited. Ireland have picked a really strong side. They're, you know, number two in the world, Grand Slam winners, Six Nation winners, and Leinster have just gone on and won the double in their domestic competition. So they're going to be a strong side, and they've picked a really strong side to tour. But equally, the Wallabies have just named their squad, and for the first time, I think for a long time, it's probably more of a case of not being able to fit people in as opposed to trying to, you know, find spots to fill the squad. So there's some great depth and great competition for all spots. So I think we're in a pretty good place to really stick it to the Irish.
Well, mate, you're looking fit. Itchy feet to get back out there at all?
No, not at all. Like, yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, with the Fox stuff, I'm around the footy a bit, and the good thing about it is it almost reinforces my decision. I don't have any urge to be out there playing. You know, I was very lucky and fortunate the career I was able to have, but I've been down to some of the training sessions, and I just sort of shudder to think that I'd have to be out there doing that sort of stuff. And I mean, you'd know the level of commitment that it takes to be at that level, you know, with everything, with it being nutrition, you know, time management with analysis and meetings and training. It's something that I did whilst I was playing, but I'm very happy that I'm not doing it now.
So how do you stay fit now that you've retired?
Mate, to be completely honest, I'm not the type of guy that just loves the training and gets up off the couch and goes out there and does that. So for me to be motivated, I need to commit to something. So basically, I need to find a goal, commit to it publicly so I'm held accountable for it, and then that way I start training towards something. Because, I mean, when I first stopped, it was my first time training in a public gym. First time not having all my teammates around me, first time not having coaches screaming at me for taking too long a rest period. So I was almost going just to tick a box, but once I picked a goal and I still was working towards it, all of a sudden it made a little bit more sense, and you know, I had objectives to get along the way. And so my goal is to run the New York Marathon. And you know, people might think that just generally because you're a footy player, you might be fit. I'm short burst, power, speed sort of stuff. So this endurance stuff is certainly not what I'm made for. But I figure, you know, that's in November, so I've got a long time to train for it, and it just means then, you know, I'm committed to staying in shape and staying healthy and staying on top of all that type of stuff, the nutrition and things, just to make sure I can at least walk across that finish line.
So your tip to the average bloke out there is set a goal.
And I think so. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, set a goal, be it, you know, could be, you know, a goal in terms of achieving something, you know, like a marathon or just a swim or whatever it might be, or it could be weight loss. I mean, whatever your motivation is, you've just got to find it. But I think once you commit to it, and also commit to it amongst your family and friends so that they can also see how you're tracking, you're held accountable. It's so easy these days with social platforms to, once you put it out there, people are going to hold you accountable for it. So that's why I just thought that was my motivation. I'll put it out there. People have asked me, you know, they kind of see me at times indulging in other things. They go, how's your marathon training going? So it kind of keeps you in check. But I would say that, I think, you know, set a goal and even maybe set one with your mates as well and buddy up, and so you've got training partners, because it's probably the one thing I've probably fallen short on with the long distance training is it can be pretty lonely. You know, and obviously, you know, you're having a few discussions with the voice in your head when you're getting sort of 10-15 k's in. But I mean, it's part of it, right? Not just the physical endurance, it's the mental endurance and all that type of thing. And I think that's what I enjoy about it is it's you know, a true contest on many different levels, and I like that.
So what did rugby teach you as far as mindset?
Well, I mean, you've got to be resilient, you know, with everything, be it, you know, your training, your recovery, also just setbacks as well, injuries, selection and that type of thing. So nothing is ever best case scenario. Nothing's ever going to go the way that you want it to go. So even the training program I've got for the New York Marathon, it's not going to go to plan. There's going to be times where I can commit to it, other times where it's going to be more difficult. But you know, and I don't know, I think from now, for me now, once I've finished, I watched a lot of, and I read a lot of the sort of the self-development stuff, and I've read one thing that that really rang true, and it's you get two types of pain, the pain of self-discipline or the pain of regret.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you got to choose wisely, right? So the times where, you know, it's easier to sort of sit there and watch another episode on Netflix, yeah, as opposed to getting up and going and do something or to recover. I prefer the pain of that self-discipline and going and doing it than, you know, the back end when I'm doing the New York Marathon, the regret when I can't finish it because I didn't do those types, yeah, of things. I prefer the former in the self-discipline stuff.
That's brilliant, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. And a lot of blokes struggle like with mental health, as do women these days. What's, yeah, your advice for them?
I think go out there and seek help. I mean, yeah, for me, you know, from, I guess when I first started, it was, you know, I guess a bit of a stigma around speaking about it. And, you know, it was something that probably people really tried to deal with internally and, yeah, and in a real sort of isolated type of manner. But as it's, as my career's gone on, the conversations have certainly started. And the way I sort of look at it is, you know, from the moment you're born, you've got a coach or a mentor or a parent teaching you how to do different things, be it walk, crawl, you know, math, English, whatever it might be. Then we go into sport, they teach you how to pass, how to kick. We've got coaches really for everything except for life itself.
Yeah.
And so the way I look at it is, you know, the people that help you with things in life are your nearest and dearest, but they can often be biased opinions, you know, because, I mean, they obviously want the best for you, but it can often be biased and not tell you how it is and not necessarily have the tools to help you deal with it. So, you know, for me, I go and see a psych, you know, quite regularly now. And it was something that I thought when I was going into the transition, you know, I was going from living in France to Australia, you know, rugby to whatever was next. And I thought, you know, I've got every potential to hit some sort of a bit of a pothole and, you know, and start to go within myself. So I thought, preemptively, I'll go and speak to someone about helping me identify some of those obstacles that I may hit and deal with them, you know, before I get to them. So I don't see it as any weakness. I think it's quite the opposite.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, if you're able to speak about it and start the discussion, you know, with friends and stuff like that, you know, I think it's certainly going to help you, not only yourself, but the people around you as well.
It's great advice. Exercise plays a huge role in your mood as well,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, the times where, you know, you don't, well, things aren't going right, be it relationship, work, or anything like that, or you just, you know, maybe you had a big weekend, yeah, and you don't feel like, and all of a sudden the demons are coming,
yeah,
back. You know, the hardest thing to do, but also the most beneficial thing to do, is get up off the couch and go out there and get active, because, you know, it just releases different things, and it, and all of a sudden you feel like you've achieved something, you're feeling better about yourself, and then you're clear in the mind, you can go and attack, you know, certain things that you've got through your week.
And food, mate, obviously that, a lot of people think they can out-exercise a bad diet, but for me, diet's king.
Yeah, diet is king, and it was probably something throughout my career that I was never huge on. you know, I really lent on the fact that I was in team situations a lot,
yeah,
so a lot of our diet was catered for, you know, in hotels and things like that on tours, but I think just an understanding of what you're putting into your body, how much you're trying to get out of your body, and just, I mean, just even on a basic level, just understanding what you got the next day, what type of energy or fuel you'll need,
yeah,
for,
yeah,
that day, you know, taper back if you've got a day off and not doing too much, or if you've got a big day with a heavy load the next day, then maybe fill yourself up with a bit more fuel. So it can go back to a basic level, so long as you've got a bit of an understanding of it,
yeah,
I think is really key.
And mate, do you have any philosophies around food yourself?
Mate, actually, I think it's all in preparation, really.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're prepared, then you're going to go out there and you're going to put the right stuff in your body.
Yeah.
If you're not, then that's when you start ordering in quite a lot. I live on my own, and there's a lot of wastage,
yeah,
you know, when you're trying to cook for yourself. And also there's sometimes you're like, oh, is it really worth cooking for one? I'll just order something in. So I get some food delivery stuff,
yeah,
where they just deliver the content, the ingredients, and then, you know, then I whip it up. And then again, it feels like you've achieved something.
Yeah, yeah.
As little as it is, I think, yeah, if you can get little things where you just feel like you've achieved stuff, I think it, you know, it's certainly great for the mindset. And, you know, what's not to like about feeling good about yourself?
Mate, do you have any morning rituals?
Morning rituals? I didn't really, you know, through my career, but then I've been introduced to a book called The Miracle Morning, and it's about just setting your alarm an hour before you would normally get up, and just getting, just doing some things like, you know, being silent, you know, putting your phone away for the first hour when you get up, just being sitting in silence for 10 minutes, you know, writing in a journal, writing down what you're grateful for, doing 10 minutes of exercise. I mean, just little things like that. Yeah. Just give yourself a little bit of time before you start your day. And I watch a lot of things and read a lot of things, make my bed as well. I mean, my father's from the military, so that was always something I had to do as a young kid.
Start
the day with already achieving something. So, and before your alarm would normally go off, you've already felt like you've done so much, and then you go out and attack the day. But I mean, that's not something I do every day, but try to do as much as I can,
And gratitude's a huge thing, is that a lot of people don't realise how great we've got it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we live in a great country. We're afforded so many beautiful things, but also grateful for the people around us and the opportunities we get. I think it's crucial to sit down and stop every now and then just to be thankful for that.
Yeah, it really helps your mood. And mate, lastly, pretty exciting times for you ahead entrepreneurially. With a business that you're going to start up. Can you tell everyone about that?
Yeah. So it's called E-Squared.
E-Squared,
yeah. And it launched in London in November of last year. Yeah. And I was put in touch with the guys that launched that. Essentially, marketing advertising type platform where you have access. It's a non-membership based model, whereas you pay as you use for health and fitness. So all the gym floors, Pilates, yoga, high intensity training, all that type of stuff, all the classes are available just for a one-off purchase for a session. So we're looking to launch here in Australia in September.
So that's exciting. And so people can basically become a member and then go to any gym they want.
Oh no, not even a member. So you just download the app and then you can just use it. So there's no buy-in, there's no lock-in. It's just you can use it once in a year, you can use it once a day. So there's absolutely no obligation. And it's just trying to encourage people to get out there and get fit and have the capacity to have variety in your training. Really good for traveling people as well, you know, interstate or internationally as well. So, it's exciting times. It's completely different to what I've been doing for 15 years. I try and liken it as much as I can to footy because, you know, I'm essentially putting a team together and I know teams pretty well. We've got an objective to launch. So it's about formulating a plan to get to that objective. And it's certainly, you know, all these business meetings and staying on top of emails and admin is not my jam, but it's going to have to be. So I'm trying as best as I can to make sure I'm on top of all that stuff.
What's your tip for blokes to get fit?
Set a goal, commit to it publicly, and then get out there and start chipping away at it.
And mate, what's your favourite healthy food?
Sushi for me. Sushi. I try and go a bit easy on the rice at times when I can. Just hit the tuna sashimi. I'm not so big on salmon because I don't like the texture. I'm a bit sensitive with the texture.
And mate, what's your favourite unhealthy food if you're going to treat yourself?
Oh, well, there's so many. I'd probably go pizza.
Pizza,
it's hard to go past, right?
And mate, drink a poison. What's your favourite drink when you want to have a relax?
Maybe a single malt whiskey or a champagne. Now that I spent a bit of time over in France, so
that's rugby. Isn't it?
Yeah, I know, mate. That's how we do it. Yeah.
And mate, music you listen to if you're trying to get yourself pumped up for a workout.
Oh, anything with a bit of a heavy beat. I generally just like, you know, a nice acoustic set when I'm, you know, just everyday music. So I'm not too fussy with it, but I need something with a bit of a beat to get me up and just get me moving a bit. That's about it.
And why should people get active and be healthy?
Oh, mate, because this is the most important thing that we've got, right? Is our health. And if you abuse that, then you're not going to be around for too long. So I think to get the most out of the opportunities that we've got in life is you've got to be healthy and you've got to be fit and get out there and get active.
Legend, mate. Well done.
No worries. Thanks very much.